You may have seen this video of Shanmugam repeatedly asking Faizal Manap if religion and politics should be kept separate.
Do you believe, I ask you for the final time, religion and politics should be kept separate? A simple answer would do.
So my speech is
forget about that particular part. Just asking you, do you believe that religion should be kept separate from politics?
Sir, to cut it short, can you please refer to the Hansard?
They were discussing the recently proposed changes to the MRHA. M-R-H-A. M-R-H-A? M-R-H-A? Mr. Ha? Is it the Joker? Nah, not that. It's the Maintenance of Religious Harmony Act. Okay, but what does it even do and why should you care? I'm Rachel and today I'm gonna try and break down the MRHA. Not the MRT lah. You all know that Singapore is a multiracial and multi-religious society. It's super important to safeguard that, to make sure everybody lives in peace and harmony.
The citizens of Singapore.
In 1990, the MRHA was passed to maintain and prevent potential threats to religious harmony. The 1980s. A turbulent time for religious harmony in Singapore. In August 1986, Christian missionaries distributed pamphlets to devotees going into temples along Serangoon Road, and that caused quite a bit of objection from the Hindus. The same year, tensions peaked between the Christians and the Muslims because of evangelical activities. Throughout the mid-1980s, several Muslim theologians were also banned from entering Singapore because they were delivering speeches or lectures that were inciting the Singapore Muslim community against the government. Following a white paper that was published in 1989, the Maintenance of Religious Harmony Bill was introduced in Parliament in 1990 by then Home Affairs Minister S. Jayakumar. The MRHA finally came into effect in 1992, allowing the government to issue restraining orders to anyone who disrupts Singapore's religious harmony. Hi! Welcome back to 2019. Things are pretty different now, especially in the age of social media where dangerous words can spread like fire. So right now, the current practice is that the restraining orders will have 14-day notice periods before it actually comes into effect. But 14 days, right, is quite long in the social media landscape, eh? And after almost 30 years, the Act is being updated. But what are the changes that are being proposed? First on the list, restraining orders. Restraining orders will now apply to online posts that are stirring up religious tensions as well. And that's because they can be even more damaging than offensive offline speeches. And the order will now take immediate effect after it is issued. No more waiting 14 days. But interestingly, right, in the last 27 years, there have been no restraining orders that were issued. Like none at all. Next, the new thing called the Community Remedial Initiative, the CRI. Cry. And under the CRI, the Home Affairs Minister may offer the person who has wounded the feelings of another, I cry, the opportunity to mend ties without prosecution. So things that they do at the CRI, sweep floor, say so. That one is CWO. I say. Things that they actually do at the CRI.
Some examples of remedial actions under the CRI include issuance of a public or private apology or participating in activities that promote religious harmony.
This is not compulsory though, but the completion of the CRI will be taken into account when assessing whether they should be prosecuted or not. Safeguarding against foreign influence. According to the MHA, foreign actors may impose values that are inappropriate for us. These can affect our religious harmony through religious organizations.
They can exert influence and control on our religious organizations through holding leadership positions, donations, or their affiliations with organizations.
It's like if someone outside of Singapore is super close to a church leader, and this certain someone is also super outspoken about hating Muslims. And then there's a little iffy what, right? To avoid all these foreign people from stirring shit, the MHA has come up with a few measures. Number one, so religious organizations will have to disclose the receipt of one-time foreign donations of $10,000 or more.
$10,000 was chosen because by the standards of donations, it was a significant amount. We had to balance between the risk and also the effort that religious organizations have to take. If you set it at too low an amount, they will have to take a lot of effort and it may not be meaningful.
So this is so that random people from outside Singapore don't anyhowly give like churches, mosques or temples a shitload of money to spread their faith. So second, religious organizations will have to disclose any affiliations to foreign individuals or organizations if these entities exert some sort of control over them. It's like purely disclosure though. So if you are a Catholic church and you need to take advice from the Vatican and the Pope, Can. Just say first lah. Third, the president, secretary or treasurer of any religious organization must be a Singaporean citizen or a PR. And the majority of the executive committee in the group must be Singaporean citizens. Penal code plus MRHA. So final thing. The religion-related offences under the penal code will now be housed under the MRHA. Religious leaders will be held to higher standards because they have more influence over religious matters. Yup, so these are the new changes to the MRHA. Yeah, it's quite timely given the global rise in religious tensions, even in countries close to home. Although the old MRHA has never been used, it's legit time for some updates.